visual system is very, very important from the point of view of clinicals as well as from the point of view of exams. So just a quick overview of where we had left off, those, especially for those who had missed. The visual system, the visual pathway starts from the retina, optic nerve. I'm not going to the details. You'll have to read up on your own, those of this out. Optic chiasma, optic tract. You can see the optic tract is winding around the cerebral peduncle. This is the cerebral peduncle of the midbrain. This is the cerebral peduncle of the midbrain. Optic tract. Next, lateral geniculate body, LGB. You'll never forget that. Lateral geniculate body. This is the lateral geniculate body, the thalamus. And yesterday, we have said that it's six layers. From the lateral geniculate body, the synapse will occur and the fourth layer of neurons will start. So LGB is where the ganglion cell acts on synapse. And I told you yesterday that the visual system has got four order neurons. So the fourth order neuron is starting from the LGB. I hope this point is clear to everybody. And the portion which starts from the LGB and reaches the occipital cortex, that segment is called the optic or the visual or the calcarine radiation. And that is a little tricky. And we had left it off here. I'm going to start now. So this is the visual for the optic radiation. This is quite tricky. So let's take off where we had, let's go back to the initial LGB, optic radiation. Now, before I start with optic radiation, yesterday I had said something very significant about the optic tract. Who will remind me what I had said? Especially somebody here, ask me a question also, and that gentleman is missing. We had said that each, yes, please continue. Each optic tract receives fibers from that side of both the retina. And we had said that means the right optic tract will receive fibers from the right half of the right retina and the right half of the left retina, yes? Likewise, the left optic tract will receive fibers from the left half of the left retina and the left half of the right retina. I hope this point was clear to everybody because I need to build up on that. So that each optic tract receives fibers from that half of both retina. Are we clear? You have simplified the whole sentence. So the same principle holds for the LGB also. Because all the fibers of the optic tract are synapsing. 90% of the fibers of the optic tract are synapsing in the LGB. So LGB also receives fibers from the same half of both retina, yes? Now let's continue with the next order of neuron from the LGB. Let's say the red one here or the blue one here. The next order of neurons which are starting from the LGB, the one which we're calling as optic radiation now, they are also serving the same thing, yes? They are serving the same half of both the retina, yes or no? I need this from you. So this whole double layer, which is shown in red here or blue here, the left one is receiving fibers from the left half of the left retina and the left half of the right retina and vice versa, clear? Now we are going to clear the pitch a little bit. Not because I want to do it, but because this is how it is. What he has done is, he has shown the optic radiation by two lines, on this side also and this side also. Actually, it is just to simplify matters, the whole optic radiation is divided into two distinct bundles. He has shown it just by two lines. Here is the actual bundle, shown diagrammatically here. Let's take a good look at that, digest that point. Optic radiation is not one fiber, it's millions of fibers spreading out like that. That's why it's called radiation. So it gets divided into two bundles. One is a medial group. Look at these set of fibers which are coming from the LGB, these fibers. These are the medial bundle of optic radiation. That is shown in a single line here and a single line here. Actually, it's a bundle of millions of fibers. And this little bundle is a little lateral to that. It's doing a little bit of weird loop here. That is a lateral bundle. I need you to look at that. So whole optic radiation gets physiologically, anatomically, and functionally divided into two bundles. They're all spread out equally, but for descriptive purposes, they are divided into a lateral bundle and a medial bundle. Are you clear with this much? Now, I need something from you. If the whole optic radiation is serving the same half of both the retina, once you divide this optic radiation into two equal bundles, let's say 1 million fibers in the medial bundle and 1 million fibers in the lateral bundle. What will this serve? Which part of the retina will it serve? Let's take the left optic radiation that was shown in red. Wonderful. Exactly, because now what happened, the optic radiation is divided into two halves. That means now each component of the radiation is serving 1/4 of the retina, yes or no? Did we get this point? I want this from you. So each component, each bundle of the optic radiation, medial and lateral, will serve 1/4 of each retina, corresponding retina. Are we clear till this much? Because the whole optic radiation is serving half of each retina. So when you divide half of half, what happens? You get 1/4, right? I need this, we need you to understand this very clearly because I'm going to start with the clinical conditions right now. So before I even start describing the optic radiation to you, the medial bundle shown here is serving 1/4 of the same retina on both the sides. And the lateral bundle is serving 1/4 of the same retina on the retina on the same side. And by same thing for this side also, the medial bundle is serving 1/4 of the retina of the corresponding side, both the eyes, and the lateral bundle is doing the same thing. Now comes the question, which one will serve the upper portion quadrant of the retina, which one will serve the lower quadrant, and I'm going to come to that right now. But did we understand that each component of the optic radiation serves 1/4 of each retina? Did we understand this much? Absolutely, no ambiguity. Okay, now let's take the medial component. The medial component is a simpler one, that's why we are starting with it first. The medial component is shown by a single light here. It actually refers to this whole millions of fibers going medial. The medial component, because it's situated more medial, that's all. The medial component, this carries fibers from the upper quadrant of both the retina. So this bundle, this is the left optic radiation medial component, right? This is receiving fibers from the left upper quadrant of the left retina and the left upper quadrant of the right retina. Are we clear? Yes? So this is receiving fibers from the upper quadrant of both the retina, same side. So much, so far, so good. The medial component, it goes straight back through the parietal lobe, which I've shown in the next picture, the medial component. It goes straight back from the LGB through the parietal lobe. Mind you, we are saying parietal lobe, it's not on the cortex, it is deep inside, it's white matter. So it is deep in the white matter. It goes straight back through the parietal lobe and reaches the occipital lobe. Now go back to the chapter on occipital lobe. We have said that the occipital lobe is divided by a calcarine sulcus, yes? Which divides the occipital lobe into a superior and an inferior bank. What name did we give the superior bank? The cuneus gyrus. And the inferior bank we named it as lingual gyrus. Wonderful. So this medial bundle, it goes straight back through the parietal lobe. The medial bundle goes straight back through the parietal lobe and ends in the cuneus gyrus. So now tell me, each cuneus gyrus serves which quadrant of retina? We had already done this in the cortex chapter.
The lower.
Got you. I'm talking the retina, not the visual field. Each cuneus gyrus serves the upper quadrants of each retina of the same side. Yes? Because it is receiving the medial bundle. You see, this is what is called retinotopic projection. Everything is going systematically. This is very important to understand. So this is the medial bundle. Now let's take the lateral bundle, the lateral component. This is a little more tricky. The lateral bundle, it is shown diagrammatically here. It is shown as this. The lateral bundle does not go straight back. Instead, it makes a forward bend towards the temporal lobe, in fact, into the temporal lobe. Of course, deep inside the temporal lobe. You can see it is making a forward bend into the temporal lobe. The fibers from the LGB are going into the temporal lobe. They enter the temporal lobe in deep inside, and then they move back. Then they move back. They travel through the temporal lobe, deep inside. Temporal lobe, as you know, is already lower down. This is the temporal lobe. So the fibers go towards the temporal lobe, and then they curve back. The previous one went through the parietal lobe. This one goes through the temporal lobe. And where will it reach? This forward bend is called, it makes a curve, is called the mayor's loop. So now let me give you a nice, sweet little mnemonic. The lateral bundle receives fibers from the lower quadrants of the same side of both retinae, forms the mayor's loop, and goes to the lingual gyrus, all LLLL. The lateral bundle receives fibers from the lower quadrant, forms the mayor's loop, and goes to the lower bank, another L, which is the lingual gyrus. This is all marked in red, blue here. So each lingual gyrus serves which quadrant of the retina? If you understand it, everything is going to be plain as daylight. Each lingual gyrus serves the lower quadrants of both the retinae. Yes? Now I'm going to do something more which you have already answered. I'm going to show you the projection of each retina on the visual field, which I'm going to do in the next slide. But right now I need you to understand this. So this whole optic radiation together travels in a portion of the white matter, which is known as the retrolenticular part of the internal capsule. Let me go back a few slides to show you which is this retro. This is a picture of the internal capsule. Anterior limb, genu posterior. This is the caudate nucleus, this is the thalamus, this is the lentiform nucleus. Are we clear about this? You all know this. You can see the lateral geniculate body. The fibers are going like this. This is behind the lenticular nucleus, that's what it's called. The retrolenticular part of internal capsule. And they travel by the optic radiation and they reach the cuneus and the lingual gyrus. The optic radiation in the parietal lobe and in the temporal lobe is supplied by MCA. When it reaches the occipital lobe, it is supplied by PCA. So optic radiation has again got dual supply. So because optic radiation, lesions and strokes are very common. So these are the few salient points about the optic radiation. Now let's come to, this is an actual dissection of the visual pathway, and you can see in an actual dissection also it looks pretty much the same. Can you see these Mayer's loop fibers? The Mayer's loop fibers going and going back, and these are the medial bundle, these are the lateral bundle. So this is an actual dissection. They would have spent maybe many weeks and months to do this dissection. So we have finished with the visual pathway. So I'm going to again quickly summarize. Retina, optic nerve, optic chiasma, optic tract. AGV, optic radiation, medial bundle, lateral bundle, cuneus gyrus, lingual gyrus. We have to know every step of the pathway because we'll have lesions at every level. Now let me show you the projection of the retina vis-a-vis the visual field. First, let me define a few terms for you. Many of these things you may know already. This visual field is defined as the sum total of the universe that we see with both our eyes open. So when we have both our eyes open, I can see this much when I'm looking straight. This is what is impinging on my visual field. There's a certain portion of the visual field where both the eyes' visual field overlaps. So that portion is shown in this hatched area here. That is the binocular visual field. There's a little bit on this side, a little bit on this side. Those are the monocular visual fields of each eye, respectively. So this is the monocular portion, this is the monocular portion. If you were to take each visual field separately, you'll find that one visual field is like this and one visual field is like this. What they've done is they've just separated the two. In actual charting, this is what we do. We chart the visual field of each eye separately. So we chart the visual field of each eye separately. This is the visual field of the right eye, this is the visual field of the left eye. Here we do not cross our hands. So this is the, what are the things we notice when we look at each monocular visual field? This is the binocular, but when we chart it, we chart each monocular visual field. What is the first thing we notice when we look at each monocular visual field? First of all, we notice that it is not a perfect circle. This is the temporal half of the visual field. I'm not talking the retina now, mind you. The temporal portion of the visual field is much more extensive than the nasal portion, yes? I'm talking of the visual field. The temporal visual field is more extensive than the nasal. Why? Because the lateral orbital margin is more recessed. And here, the medial orbital margin is more projecting by virtue of the nose. That is the reason. Can anybody tell me why phylogenetically the temporal visual field is more developmentally, evolutionary-wise? Just think and answer.
Slow process. Slow process.
When we were Ramapithecus and Australopithecus, Yes, predators like the Velociraptor always comes from the sides. Isn't it? Remember Jurassic Park? Prey never comes from the front, predators. So nature gave us a wider visual field on the temporal side. We can see the movement back. Okay, let's come back to business. Look at the exact center, geometric center. What do you see here? Exact geometric center. This is the macular visual field. That is the area of maximum visual acuity. So when we're looking at an object clear, straight, this is the macular visual field. So it is the geometric center. I mean, it's not strictly geometric center, but it is the geometric center of the eye. We take a vertical line through that, and we take a horizontal line through, similarly on this side. And that's how we divide the visual field into four quadrants, as you can see there. So what quadrant will you name this as, visual field? Superior nasal, upper nasal, wonderful. What quadrant will you name this as? Lower temporal quadrant of the left visual field. What will you name this as? Lower temporal visual, temporal quadrant of the right visual field. So on and so forth. This is how we will divide. Let's continue with our story. If you look just 15, suppose I am the person and this is my visual field, right eye, this is my visual field of my left eye, so this is my macular visual field. If I just look 15 degrees to the temporal side, if I just look 15 degrees to the temporal side, can you see a black dot here? What do you think that is?
Blind.
Wonderful. That is the physiological blind spot, or the physiological scotoma. I'm going to use that word scotoma just after this portion of the chapter. Scotoma means a blind spot. And this represents the area where there is no rods and cones. So this is the place where you have a blind spot. Why is the blind spot the temporal part of the visual field? Can anybody tell me? Based on yesterday, what we saw. I told you about the fundus yesterday. Why is the blind spot in the temporal part of the visual field? Okay, you're right, but that does not answer my question. When we described the retina, remember, we said that the physiological blind spot, or the optic disc, is situated nasal to the macula, yes or no? Did we say it is situated nasal to the macula? So if something is situated nasal to the macula, its projection on the visual field is going to be diametrically opposite, it's temporal. The reason is because the light from the world crosses like a pinhole camera at our pupil. So anything from the right goes to the left and vice versa. Anything from the temporal goes to the nasal and vice versa. And that is what I'm going to tell you next in the next slide. So because the optic disc is situated nasal to the macula, its visual field representation will be in the temporal part of the visual field. Are we clear about this? So this is the optic disc, the blind spot. It is approximately 50 degrees from the center, 50 degrees temporal to the center. Okay, so now that we have understood the bare fundamental essentials, these are some of the things which again we'll be repeating in FCM, in the second FCM, not the today's one. Now let me show you how the eye is represented, how the visual field is represented in each retina, and how it continues through the optic tract, optic radiation, and so on and so forth. Take a look at this picture. This is the right eye, this is the left eye. Look at the color coding, orange, orange, blue, blue. He has done it with a specific purpose. This is the visual field, this portion is the binocular, this is the monocular of one side, this is the monocular of one side. Are we clear about this much? Look at the light rays crossing in the pupil. Look at the light rays crossing in the pupil. Light rays from the left, they are crossing and they're falling in the right half of this retina and they're falling in the right half of this retina, yes? Likewise, the light rays from the blue portion, which is on the right side, is crossing at the pupil and falling on the left half of this retina and the left half of this retina, yes? This is the pinhole effect. When there's a pinhole at the pupil, the light rays cross diametrically opposite. The same principle applies in the superior and inferior quadrant also. Light rays from the top will go to the lower part of the retina, and light rays from below will go to the upper part of the retina. This point also has to be remembered. So here he's showing only the right left. Now, when we were talking about the retina, we said that the optic nerve in the chiasma, the medial fibers, the nasal fibers cross, yes? If you see carefully, you'll see that this is the nasal fiber blue from this retina, yes? And from this retina, this is the orange. Can you see their crossing? Why is this crossing done? It is again not random. It is done with a very specific purpose. Once the nasal fibers cross and they go to the optic tract, the temporal fibers don't cross. Yes? So the temporal fiber, which is shown in blue here, remains on the same side, and the temporal fiber from here, which is shown in orange, did not cross. So the nasal fibers crossed, the temporal fibers did not cross. Once they reach the optic tract, now do you see the color coding has become uniform? The left optic tract now is carrying only the blue fibers, and the right optic tract is carrying only the orange fibers. Did you notice that? So what does it mean? It means that the left optic tract, which I said in the beginning of this class, receives fibers from the left half of the left retina and the left half of the right retina. I think that's exactly what we said, right? Likewise, the right optic tract, it receives fibers from the right half of the right retina and the right half of the left retina. Make sense? Now project the optic tract to the visual field. Project the optic tract to the visual field. First, you've understood which tract, each tract receives fibers from which part. If the left optic tract, the blue, receive fibers from the left half of each retina, what is the visual field of the left of each retina? Right of each, yes? So, let's boil down to the next simple level. Each optic tract serves the opposite half of the visual field of both eyes, yes? Are we clear? Same thing applies to the right side. Look at the orange. Orange is receiving fibers from the right half of both the retina. So, the right half of both the retina serves which visual field? The left half of both the visual fields. So, each right optic tract serves the left half of the visual field of both the eyes. So far, so good? Because I'm going to exactly build up on the same theme when I started the clinical portion. Let's continue now from the optic tract to the LGB. Same thing holds. LGB is also receiving fibers from the same half of both the retina. So therefore, each LGB is serving the opposite half of the visual fields of both the eye. Yes? Yes, because each optic tract has an LGB. Then from the LGB, we have the optic radiation. Suppose I were to consider the optic radiation as a whole bundle without dividing it into medial and lateral. Each optic radiation as shown by this will serve which part of the visual field? Just extrapolate and tell me. Each optic radiation, it serves the opposite half of the visual field of both the eyes. Yes or no? So left optic radiation as a whole, let's say 2 million fibers, whatever number you want to go, is serving the right half of the visual fields of both the eyes. Because it is receiving fibers from the left half of the retina, which is serving the opposite half of the visual field. Did we get this point absolutely clear? Once you've understood it, there's nothing to read any further. Now you can go straight to the clinical part. Now what we did, we took the optic radiation, because we are sadists, we broke it up into two bundles, into a medial bundle and a lateral bundle. And what did we say was the medial bundle carrying? We said the medial bundle was carrying fibers from the upper quadrant of the same side retina of both the eyes, yes? So if the medial bundle is carrying fibers from the upper quadrant of the same side of both the retina, which visual field will it serve? Answer me. So make it more precise. It will serve the opposite side, lower quadrants of both the visual fields. Are we clear? And what did we say about the lateral bundle, the Mayer's loop? It received fibers from the same side, lower quadrant of each retina, yes? So which visual field will it serve? Upper temporal quadrant, upper quadrant of the opposite side of both the visual fields. Clear? Let's continue now. The visual optic radiation ended in the occipital cortex. Let's consider the whole occipital cortex, irrespective of cuneus gyrus, lingual gyrus. Each occipital cortex serves which visual field? We mentioned this in the occipital cortex chapter. I just narrowed it down straight to the simplest form when we were talking about the occipital cortex. We said each occipital cortex serves the opposite half of the visual fields of both the eye. Now you can extrapolate it in terms of the visual pathway. Now again we'll break it up. Because we said the medial bundle goes to the cuneus gyrus and the lateral bundle goes to the lingual gyrus. So each cuneus gyrus serves which part of the visual field? Opposite, lower quadrant of both the visual fields. And each labeled iris, suppose this thing serves the upper quadrant of the visual fields of both the eye. Are we clear absolutely about this? Once you've understood this, you are good to go. This is a wonderful diagram called optic caling, where he has given, in a color-coded fashion, the visual field in a three-dimensional imaginary way, and he has given multiple color-coded lines, how each part of the visual field projects to each part of the retina, and how the fibers cross, and all the NGV, blah, 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 and reaches the visual cortex. So, I mean, if you want to look at it, you'll find that it will enhance you, but I think all of you have really understood it. There's something you need to understand, you can and use yourself, but don't spend too much time. Now let's come to the next last part of this chapter, and then we will start the clinicals. So we are finished with the visual part and its projection, the visual field, etc. Now the remaining part of this chapter is equally, if not more important, the various visual reflexes. I think we have been talking about visual reflexes right in the smart board chapter, remember? Now we are going to go to the depths of, there are several reflexes, out of which three of them we will know in detail, and the other two we will mention in passing. Before that, you have to have a very thorough understanding of the autonomic supply of the eye. That's why I put this picture here. So we will cover it again in CN3. In simple terms, what is the sympathetic supply to the iris do? Sympathetic supply. These are all physiology anatomy for you. So it produces pupillary dilatation, mydriasis. Sympathetic supply comes from the superior cervical ganglion. We will mention this again in detail when we come to the autonomic nervous system. Superior cervical ganglion supplies the dilator pupillae in the iris and causes dilatation. Superior cervical attacks from the alpha-1 receptors. You don't know that yet. Parasympathetic. Where does it come from? You know this. CN3, okay. Remember an Edinger-Westphal nucleus in the midbrain, which we said was the parasympathetic component of CN3? Edinger-Westphal nucleus is shown here. The Edinger-Westphal nucleus gives the parasympathetic component, which is coming out with CN3. CN3 is coming from the front of the midbrain. Remember the two red arrows in your exam? It's coming out from the front of the, it's traveling with the CN3. It synapses in the ciliary ganglion. Postganglionic fibers then go and supply the sphincter pupillae. Sphincter pupillae is the inner one, the dilator pupillae is the outer one. Supplies muscarinic receptors. What is pupillary constriction or meiosis? Are we clear? So parasympathetic, pupillary constriction, sympathetic, pupillary dilatation. Constriction is called meiosis, dilatation is called mydriasis. So this is in simple terms. The sympathetic and parasympathetic, all the visual reflexes will be dependent on these two concepts. Okay, now let's go to the nuts and bolts. The ones shown in blue are the ones which we need to know in great detail. So I'll just name them first and then we'll take one by one. The pupillary or the light reflex, the accommodation of the near response, the corneal or the blink reflex, and the pupillary skin reflex. These are the ones we will take them. So let's start with the first one, the pupillary or the light reflex. First, what are the components of this reflex? What is this reflex? Because you will be doing this in FCM and you will be asked questions on this. This is the most frequently tested procedure that you will do in any patient who comes to you. When I shine a torchlight in any one eye, the pupils of that side constrict and the pupil of the opposite eye also constricts. Constriction of the pupil of the same side is called direct light reflex, and the constriction of the pupil of the opposite side is called consensual light reflex. Are we clear? In the exams, trust me, believe me, when they write this word, when the doctor showed a light, there was no consensual response, but there was a direct response. They write like that, and people get flummoxed. So you have to understand, that means the opposite side did not react, but this side reacted. That's what they're trying to say. So these are the components of the light reflex. Also called the pupillary reflex, so the light reflex. Now let's take a look at the pathway. It is called the retino-mesencephalic pathway. We will make it simple. This may look a little dense for you. I'm going to make it simple. This picture relates to this. Okay, let me apologize for this slide. What I have done is I've added one picture, which is not there earlier. I know you have got a right to jump at me because I realize that I need to tell you something. So I just tweaked it a little bit just this morning. I suddenly thought, okay. So the initial part of the pathway is the same. Retina, optic nerve, optic chiasma, optic track.
Low pass filter.
Remember yesterday when I was talking about optic track, I said 90% of the fibers go to the LGBS. But I said a small percent of fibers do not go to the LGB. They go somewhere else. Remember I said that? I said one of them where they go is pre-tectal nucleus. Another one we said, three other cases, we'll not talk about that. Some of the fibers do not go to the LGB. They instead branch off to the pre-tectal nucleus. And where was the pre-tectal nucleus located? Where you would be in the brainstem? It is located in the midbrain, just adjacent to the superior colliculus. So this is the superior colliculus. Superior colliculus nucleus, just adjacent to that is the pre-tectal nucleus. And that is shown diagrammatically here. That is shown diagrammatically here. So they instead, from the optic tract, they branch off. They go to the pretectal nucleus. It is shown in a very diagrammatic fashion here. CN2 going to the pretectal nucleus. Here the synapse. This tract, this portion, is called the retinomesencephalic tract. Because it's going from the retina to the mesencephalon. Mesencephalon is midbrain. And this segment, which goes to the pretectal nucleus, this segment is the superior brachium. The brachium of the superior colliculus, which you mentioned in the brainstem. This is the reason why you have to keep going back and forth between brainstem, because we are using these terms which are not new to you, but you must refresh your memory what I mean. So they reach the pretectal nucleus. Now something happens in the pretectal nucleus. The pretectal nucleus sends crisscrossing fibers to both the sides, Edinger-Westphal nucleus. Just how I put Edinger-Westphal nucleus is the parasympathetic nucleus of CN3. So this pretectal nucleus, this is easier to understand, that's why I'm using this picture. The same thing is shown there also. Each pretectal nucleus sends to this side parasympathetic and sends to the same side. The opposite side also sends here and here. So at one place, the fibers are crossing, yes or no? I need you to note that. The place where the fibers are crossing, that is called, anybody? Posterior commission. That is the reason I put this picture, because I wanted to show you the posterior commission. It was covered when we were doing the white matter of the cerebral cortex, remember? This is the posterior commission. It is located under the pineal gland. Does it ring a bell? The posterior commission is located just under the pineal gland, just above the superior colliculus. That is the reason I brought this picture. So this is the posterior commission diagrammatically. This is the posterior commission actually. So the crossing fibers cross the posterior commission. Why do they have to cross? Did we say just now that if I have to shine a torchlight in your right eye, both your eyes should constrict? So to get this consensual response, you need this crossing over the fibers. Make sense? Once the fibers have synapsed in the from the pretectal to the Edinger-Westphal, the preganglionic fibers from the parasympathetic nucleus, they travel with CN3, as we mentioned just a little while back, and they synapse in the ciliary ganglion, which I showed you in the previous, the synapse in the ciliary ganglion. And the short ciliary nerves carry the postganglionic fibers to the sphincter pupillae of both the eyes and the pupil constrictors. So therefore, in a nutshell, afferent is CN2, and efferent is bilateral CN3. I need you to understand this point. This is a brainstem reflex. Unlike a spinal reflex, this is a brainstem reflex, and the best way to do it is we will make a diagrammatic representation. It's shown there also. Afferent is CN2. Efferent is bilateral CN3. Why am I saying this? Same thing applies to this side also. If I shine a torchlight here, afferent will be CN2, bilateral CN3. Because in the clinical portion of this chapter, we are going to create lesions. And I'm telling you now itself, if I shine a torchlight in this eye, and I find that the person's this eye is not responding, this is responding. That's what I mean by saying that when you shine a torchlight in almost right eye, there was no consensual response. That's all I'll say. I won't say anything more. Where's the lesion? I'll say that. I shined a torchlight in the right eye, and there was no consensual response. That's all I'll say. Where is the lesion? A, B, C, D, E. Just look at that formula. I shine a torchlight in the right eye. There was no consensual response. That means there's a CN3 paralysis on the left side. I shone a torchlight on the right eye, and there was only a consensual response. CN3 on the same side. I shined a torchlight on the right eye, and there was no direct or consensual response. Same side, CN2. Make sense? You see? Apply this formula, things become like, you know, clear and great daylight. This is how you will be given questions. And that's exactly what you do also. It's not a theoretical situation. This is what we do. So this is the pupillary light reflex, direct and consensual, as is shown here. Now let's go back. What happens when the pineal gland enlarges? I'm repeating something which you know already. When this pineal gland enlarges, what does it do? It compresses on the posterior commissure. When it compresses on the posterior commissure, which is this here, what does it do? It knocks off the pupillary light reflex of both the sides. Remember, we had Argyle Robertson pupil, where accommodation reaction was present, which I'm going to mention in the next slide, but there was no ARP, accommodation reaction present, pupillary reaction absent. Now do you know how it works? Because it compressed and knocked out the posterior commissure, therefore there was no pupillary light reaction. Are we clear on either side? Make sense? Let's take the exact physiological opposite. Did we consider something called cortical blindness when we were doing the occipital cortex? We call it Antle syndrome, top of the basilar syndrome. What did we say about cortical blindness? We said that the person is blind. He cannot see, but he confabulates, but he's not aware that he's blind. He's blind, but he's not aware. However, if you shine a torchlight, you find his pupils are reactive. So it's the exact opposite situation, yes or no? What happens? Because his pupils are reacting because his retinomesencephalic pathway is intact. His retinomesencephalic pathway is intact, therefore his pupillary reaction is present, but his occipital cortex is not functioning, therefore he cannot see. Make sense? Because the retinomesencephalic pathway did not go to the occipital cortex. From the optic tract, it branched off into the midbrain. Did we understand this? You have to understand the basis of why we are talking all these things. So even if a person has got occipital infarction, the so-called cortical blindness, he may not be able to see. Yet, surprisingly, when you shine a torchlight, you find both his pupils are reactive. That indicates that his retinomesencephalic pathway is fine. The occipital cortex may have gone. Did you understand this? And that is what is mentioned here. So try to understand the ramifications. All of these are understanding. Now let's come to the next reflex, the accommodation reflex, which is also equally important because again you'll be doing this in your FCM and you'll be testing in your exams. What are the components of this accommodation reflex? Three components. It's all mentioned here. It's also called the near response. When I'm looking at an object at a distance which is coming closer and closer to my face, about 5 or 7, 8 centimeters or 10 centimeters, or you try to look at the tip of your nose, just for the fun and sake of it. What are the three things which happen to your eyes? Two things you can see from outside, one thing you cannot see from outside. But three things happen. Both eyes converge, wonderful, one component. Next. Both the pupils constrict, wonderful. Next component. What's the third thing which happens, which I said you can't see, but it happens? Yes, yes, yes. Wonderful. The lens increases its curvature and increases its refractive index. Why does it have to do that? Because now the object is very close. If it does not increase its refractive index, the light will fall behind my head. So you want to converge the light rays even more, right? You know, how do you make it converge? Go back to your physics. By increasing the refractive index of the lens. By making it more curved. So that the light rays will converge more and follow my retina. But this you can't see from outside, but it happens. Something you will have to make it happen. So these are the three components of the accommodation response or the near response. Clear? Now let's look at the pathway. This pathway is called, the previous pathway we call it as the retinomesencephalic, remember? This pathway is called the occipitomesencephalic. This pathway is called the occipitomesencephalic. So you have already guessed something. This pathway involves something from the occipital cortex to the midbrain. And that's why I show you in the form of a simple line diagram. So let's take a little more. I'll make it very simple. The first part of the pathway is the same as the visual pathway. That means everything. Retina, optic nerve, optic chiasma, full optic tract, LGB, optic radiation, occipital cortex. Full. Same. So no repetition. The next part of the pathway, from the occipital cortex, fibers go to the frontal eye field. Does it ring a bell? Where was the frontal eye field? Frontal eye field was in frontal area, little frontal gyrus. Yes? Remember the one which is responsible for turning both eyes to the opposite side? So fibers from the occipital, they go to the frontal eye field on the same side and frontal eye field on the same side. Story is not over yet. From the frontal eye field, fibers descend down through the internal capsule to the pit. And that is what is shown here and shown here. This is the corticotectal part. Cortex to the tectum. Tectum is midbrain. Superior valvulus. From the midbrain, it goes to the special nucleus in the motor nucleus of CA3. We have named it when we are doing the brain stem. We call it the convergence center or the nucleus of Purley. Do we remember? So it goes to the convergence center or the nucleus of Purley. And what does this do? It activates the medial rectus of both the eye. So both the eyes converge. Make sense? The first component is over. So it goes to the convergence center, nucleus of Purley, which is the medial convergence tunnel. But everything is happening simultaneously, but we are describing it separately. What are the other two components which were remaining? Temporary constriction. Fibers go to the Ettinger Westphal nucleus just like the previous. And goes to CN3 and helps constrict the tissue. Same. One more component is remaining. Which one was that? Increase in the curvature. Fibers also from the Ettinger Westphal nucleus go to another muscle, serratus muscle. It goes to the serratus muscle, and once the serratus muscle contracts, we increase the curvature. There you go. So you've got all the three components. We describe them separately, but they all happen simultaneously. Convergence, sphincter pupillae, constriction of the pupils, and serratus muscle. So upper portion of the Ettinger Westphal nucleus supplies the sphincter pupillae, lower portion of the Ettinger Westphal nucleus supplies the you got all the components. So this is the occipitome mesencephalic pathway. In the clinical portion of this chapter, we will see a series of conditions which are known as light near dissociation. Right now, I'm just going to define it for you, but I'm going to use this term later. But before I describe it for you, you tell me what you understand this meaning of the word light near dissociation. Light near dissociation. Does it mean something? Something has been dissociated from something. Let me define it for you. I'm going to use it very quickly. There are many components of this idea. Light near dissociation means the person has got accommodation near response, but person does not have light response. That means that there is a dissociation. Person's eye is responding to accommodation, but the person's eye is not responding to light. And you already know one such condition. R. Guy Robertson pupil is one example of right near dissociation, where eye is responding to the accommodation but is not responding to the light. We will see a series of these conditions. All of them are collectively clubbed under this heading called light near dissociation. You see, these terms are all dependent on these pathways. So this is the second important reflex that we need to. Let me complete this just a few more slides and we'll take a break. The corneal or the plank reflex. Again, this is the brainstem reflex. And again, it follows the same principle which I mentioned there. First, what are the components of the reflex? Who shall I use in my guinea pig? Shall I use you? The light near response, the corner of the blink reflex is either, actually it is mentioned in your FCM lab, but we mention it to tell you not to do it. With a wisp of cotton, the other person will look to the opposite side, and from the lateral aspect, you touch, just lightly touch the cornea. You're not asked to do it because you will produce corneal abrasion. Even if you try to do it, that side eye will blink and the opposite eye will also blink. So this is also a sensory reflex. Same side eye will blink and the opposite eye will also essentially protective reflex. So let's look at the pathway. It's not as complicated, but again there will be some crossing over of fibers because both sides. Afferent. afferent. CNV1 of Calgate. Afferent going through CNV1. Which nucleus? This question was one of those which I've identified many of you. Spinal nucleus of trigeminal. You touched a cold test tube of cold water on the face. Which nucleus was the question? And 25% of you got it right. Spinal nucleus of trigeminal receives pain, temperature, and light touch from the cornea. Spinal nucleus of trigeminal. In the video also I said you must know all the names of the nuclei of trigeminal nerve. So it goes to the spinal nucleus of trigeminal, which is shown here. It's a long nucleus. Goes to the spinal nucleus of trigeminal. The upper portion receives light from the cornea, the lower portion receives pain and temperature from the face. From the spinal nucleus of trigeminal, by means of internal shell fibers, axons, which go through the medial longitudinal fasciculus. This is shown just by means of one line here. It is shown here a little more extensively. It goes through both the sides, CN7 motor nucleus. CN5, spinal nucleus of trigeminal, is in the pons, and both the motor nuclei of the CN7 is also in the pons. And that is why he has shown the picture of the pons here. Remember the big belly of the pons. They go to both sides, CN7. CN7, in turn, sends its motor fibers out to the orbicularis of the iliac muscle of both the sides and causes the pain. So again, let's look at the same principle, and again you'll be asked questions. So let me just change this to CN5, CN7, CN7. Cornea oblique reflex, afferent is CN5, efferent is both sides CN7, yes? Now again answer my question. I tried to touch his left cornea and there was no consensual response. What is, where is the site of lesion? I'm giving him all the questions which are asked in the shelf, NVNE and blocks. I touched his left cornea and there was no consensual response. CN7 on the right side is gone. I touched his left cornea and there was no direct or consensual response. Where is the lesion? Messed up just now. I touched his left cornea and there was no consensual or direct response. CN5 on the left side. So you see, I'm going to give multiple options. CN5 left, CN5 right, CN5 both, CN7 left, CN7 right. When you look at those options, you get all topsy-turvy. Don't even look at the options. Just read the question, think of the answer, go straight to the answer, and take it and get out. That is how you answer. When you know the stuff and you look at the options, because I'm a tricky guy, you know that, isn't it? So go straight to the answer. So this is how you'll answer questions. And it's all mentioned there. This is also another brainstem reflex, and it's a very useful reflex which is seen, even which is done in unconscious patients also. You want to see whether the person, I'm coming to you, if the person is unconscious and you want to determine whether there's any lesion on the brainstem or not. Because the patient is not able to tell you because they're not unconscious. So you just test cornea. And you find it's responding, that means the brainstem is intact. Because this is happening in the brainstem, the pons. So this is the clinical use of this. So these brainstem reflexes are used. Mind you, these brainstem reflexes are different from spinal reflexes. Spinal reflexes are monosynaptic reflexes, reflex arcs. Only one synapse. Here there are two synapses. First it goes to one nucleus, then it goes to another nucleus. So there's an afferent nucleus, there's an efferent nucleus. Are we clear? There's an afferent nucleus, which is in this case spinal nucleus of trigeminal, and there's an efferent nucleus, which is the CN7 motor nucleus. The previous one also, there was an afferent nucleus, the pretectal nucleus, and the efferent nucleus was Edinger Westphal nucleus. Okay, you're asking something. Yes? Yes, if there's no direct non-consensual reflex, that means the CN5 did not even take the afferent. Right? And if there's no direct response, but there's a consensual response, what's the answer? If there's touch his left cornea, there was no direct response, but there was a consensual response. What does it mean? CN7. Makes sense? So if you look at this formula, things become much easier. Okay. Serious spinal reflex, I'm not going to the details now, but it's an important reflex. All I'll tell you is that the serious spinal reflex is, suppose somebody wears a new shirt, and what do you do to that person? you pinch the person's back here, isn't it? You pinch. When you do that, what happens to the person? This person is very sensitive, by the way.
Yeah, it
hurts. It hurts, isn't it?
Yes.
So it looks like you've already been the victim of it. So when you pinch somebody painfully, the pupils dilate. This is called the pupillary skin reflex. Next time you want to try it out, you can go home and try it out on each other. That is called the pupillary skin reflex. It's also called the ciliospinal reflex. I'm not going to the details now because I'm going to describe this whole thing in much more detail in the autonomic nervous system chapter as part of the Horner syndrome. In Horner syndrome, we will describe the full pathway. That's why I'm not going to describe it now, but I told you what is the reflex. And in Horner syndrome, this reflex is gone. So this is the dilator response. Finally, the last one, the various body reflexes. I've just broken them up into different components, but I'm just going to name them, that's all. The first one is the visual body reflex. What is an example of a visual body reflex?
Somebody gives you?
That was a visual body reflex. When you see something, you give a response. Because she saw something and she responded, isn't it? It can also be something very benign, like you're holding a newspaper. Your lips are moving, your head is moving. That's also the type of visual body reflex. So these are some examples. What is the afferent? Afferent is the retinopectoral tract. To the superior colliculus, not to the pretectal nucleus. And the efferent is retinopectoral tract, and the efferent is tectospinal and tectobulbar. Retinopectoral tract to the superior colliculus. Go back to superior colliculus. What did you say it is concerned with? Visual body reflexes and spinal visual reflexes. So retinotectal, and tectospinal and tectobulbar. It goes to many muscles. It goes to muscles of the body, it goes to muscles of the head. That's why we call it tectospinal and tectobulbar. Depends on which part of the body you're moving. Next one, spinovisual reflexes. You get something, this is a cockroach there. So something tickled you and you jumped. So that was your spinovisual reflex. Something stimulated you. So the first part of the component was the spinopectoral tract, which we've already seen just in the passing. And the different component is the tectospinal tract. Spinopectoral, tectospinal. And the third component is the audiovisual reflex. You hear a sound, you turn that way. So fibers from the optic tract go to the medial geniculate body. And fibers from the inferior and superior colliculus, they connect with each other. The so-called lightning thunder reflex. So this is the audiovisual. So these are all the lesser important ones. We just rename the names of the reflexes. Now we take our break. And in the same vein, we will start with the clinical portion of the chapter. And you'll find that we're going to go exactly the same way. First part of the chapter will be all the visual pathway lesions, and the next part of the chapter will be visual reflexes. Yes.